might be as well. If you want the Wi-Fi password, I'm going to give it out right now, so be at the ready if you need it. It is drama with a capital D, then in all caps, guild with an exclamation point. So feel free to tweet and all that jazz. Also, we do have one final panel tomorrow night, and that's back at the ranch at Samuel French. So please join us for that. And be sure to get a copy of our white paper on the way out, which has more information on anti-piracy. So to kick it off, I'm going to turn it over to Sam French's lit manager, Amy Rose Marsh.
Thank you.
And let's do it.
Thank you. Thank you. Coming to our third panel, which is on publishing our work, but it's an interesting panel because it's not, I think, what we'd conventionally think of as publishing your work. So we're not going to talk about, you know, Sam French necessarily, or MTI, or RNH, or DPS. We're going to talk about how the internet has kind of affected the publishing world and new platforms for digital script sharing. So what a playwright can do to get their script out there electronically and kind of new ways of communicating with theater enthusiasts about new plays. And with me I have some very brilliant minds, some very innovative minds that are kind of on the forefront of digital sharing, and I'd like to introduce them and read to you some snippets of their bios. So over here to my right, we have Gwydion Suilebhan, and he is the author, he's a playwright, the author of Butcher, Reels, Hot and Cold, Extract Nude, Let X, The Faith Killer, and Cracked. Gwydion lectures on theater and technology. He's the director of New Play Exchange. And you also work with National New Play Network. And he's also on the DC representative for the Dramatists Guild, correct?
That's all right.
So he's here a lot. Quite a bit. Recent engagements include South by Southwest, the Dramatists Guild National Conference, TEDx Michigan Avenue, and TEDx WDC, which I'm assuming is Washington, D.C.
Yes.
His commentary often appears on HowlRound in the Dramatist and at his website, which is www.suilebhan.com, but you should look at your form because his last name is not how you'd think it would be spelled. And then next to Gwydion is Martin Denton. Who I hope all of you know, Martin was the founder of a very influential theater review site, New York.
NYTheater.com.
Yeah, and has recently launched a platform, Indie Theater Now, which is an online publishing platform that exists digitally. He'll talk a little bit about it later. In addition, he's also edited 14 print anthologies. He's a founder of New York Theater Experience podcast series, which has been on the air since 2006. He's also received numerous awards, including a New York Innovative Theater Foundation Award and an Our Town Thanks You Award for a service to the Manhattan theater community. Then next to him, we have a pair, Kait Kerrigan and Brian Lowdermilk, Kerrigan and Lowdermilk, who are a music theater duo. They're also the founders of newmusictheater.com. Which, you'll talk about it, but it's for sheet music and digital exchange of sheet music. And they also have a number of shows, including Henry and Mudge, the unauthorized autobiography of Samantha Brown, Tales from the Bad Years, and Republic. And then lastly, we have Sean Patrick
Flahaven,
thank you. Right. I was going to say
sure, you can pronounce his name correctly.
Yeah. I practiced. So Sean Patrick is the Senior Vice President of Theater and Catalog Development at Warner Chappell Music. He's a writer, composer, orchestrator, conductor, producer, and music publisher. He's a music administrator for Sondheim, Lopez, Kit and Yorkie, Miranda, and others. He also manages the song catalog of the majority of the Great American Songbook. Additionally, he serves on the board of the Music Publishers Association, the ASCAP S&C Committee, and the Dramatists Guild Anti-Piracy Committee, and he had a wonderful article on HowlRound.com today, which I'd encourage you all to go and read if you haven't already. It's great, and I hope you talk about some things that you wrote in that article earlier today. So I kind of want to talk, I briefly mentioned what you guys do or what your platforms are, and so I was hoping that we'd go around and you can give us a bit more of an in-depth introduction. Kind of where did these ideas generate from? How did this New Play Exchange started? And kind of what the goals of these digital script sharing services are? So, yeah, we can start with you, I think. Yeah.
So the new Play Exchange is a new platform designed to transform the way plays and playwrights on the one hand and producers, theaters, on the other hand, connect with each other. It is being developed by a consortium of nonprofits, the National New Play Network, Chicago Dramatists, Playwrights Foundation, Playwrights Center in Minneapolis, and Literary Managers and Dramaturgs of the Americas, and under the auspices of NNPN, the 70 theaters that make up the NNPN network. Essentially, it's a national database of new plays. Playwrights have one place on which they can upload their scripts and tag them with keywords and cast and genre and that sort of thing. And then it's a robust set of search and filtering tools that that theaters and contests and et cetera can go to look for work. It's intended to replace the submission process, right? Mm-hmm. That's the old technology, and we are upgrading it with the new Play Exchange.
So you can talk a little bit about that upgrade. How is it?
Yeah, so you know, right now there are about 15,000 makers of new work in the United States, just for example, and they are making an average of one new piece a year. At the same time, there are about 1,500 world premieres every year in the United States, and we have technology that filters 1,500 out of that 15,000, and that's the submission process. And it's broken for everyone, and we've tried to patch it with agents and submission windows and fees and contests, anything and everything we can do to kind of make it work and jury-rig it, and people still hate it. Nobody likes the 1,500 that end up on stage. Everyone's got quibbles with it, and literary managers and dramaturgs are sitting behind stacks of plays that are so heavy they can't see over them, that you know they have to eat their lunch while they read, and life is horrible. Playwrights are searching out there in the wild, trying to find places to share their work, and it's kind of a madness to keep up with where they're distributing their work. And theaters are overwhelmed with the submission. They're not actually using the submission process to find work at all. Even if they keep their submission process open, they're actually finding new work by networking and relating to, you know, doing searches among their friends by emailing their contacts and their lists. And that's the real way. So we wanted to say, hey, if that's the real way, let's use technology to enhance that real way and actually get playwrights connected to that process in a more holistic way. So we talk about the new Play Exchange as a neutral platform built for the common good of the American theater.
And just to clarify, this is a platform that's open to all writers.
All writers, yes. Well, right now we're in beta testing. So we're only open to writers affiliated with our partner organizations and theaters affiliated with our partner organizations. But we're actually looking to move up our timetable because people are like, let me in, and we want to let people in. And so far the beta testing has been really smooth. There have been very few bugs. So we just want to open the doors quicker. So we're hoping to move up what was going to be a January open to the entire world to sometime earlier in the fall.
Right. And so, Martin, you have a similar, it is also a electronic script exchange in a way.
Can you
talk about kind of how Indie Theater Now started and what where the idea came from?
Yeah, I'd love to.
Yeah.
So I'm the executive director of a nonprofit company called the New York Theater Experience. We've been around since 1999. And for the first 15 or so years, or maybe not quite 15, first 12 years or so of our existence, we were basically running a website called nytheater.com, which was a listings and reviews website focused on the New York theater community, and in particular, niching the indie theater world. We learned quickly that the productions, the artists and theater productions that didn't have budgets to be Broadway shows or off-Broadway shows were the ones that we would do the most good for. And so we spent most of our time and resources over the years on nytheater.com working with and promoting the work of these thousands of other artists who are in the indie slash off-Broadway world. And at the same time, we had another project in our company, which was the annual Plays and Playwrights Anthology, which started in 2000. And in that, we were able to publish about 8 to 10 plays every year from among the many, many plays that we saw every year. And at least, basically, our idea always was to be the point of first publication for emerging, interesting playwrights. So we were the first people to publish playwrights like Ken Urban and Queen Nguyen and Mike Liu and Saviano Stanescu and Chiori Miyagawa and and 150 other people who a great start for their career, and we always made it a point not to publish more than one play by someone because it's so expensive and so costly to produce and market a book, a real book, that one a year was all we could manage. So as technology came along and the internet evolved and life evolved, in around 2011, we had the idea to sort of marry our two skill sets and create this new website, which is called Indie Theater Now. So we're actually just 2 weeks away from, or 3 weeks away from our third birthday. Wow. And Indie Theater Now basically combines our ability to publish plays, but we're doing it electronically, so that instead of publishing 8 plays a year by 8 different playwrights, in less than 3 years, we've published 955 plays by 596 playwrights. So we're able to get a great deal more work out in front of the public than we ever were able to afford to do in the print medium. In addition, the mytheater.com part of the expertise, which had to do with not only reviewing theater, but also interviewing playwrights and other artists and doing the podcast, as you mentioned, and a whole bunch of other things, profiling artists, so that we can provide background and context about all the work that we publish, and that still happens. So, for example, we're about to start for the 13th year in a row to review every show in the New York International Fringe Festival, which is a great source of where we meet new playwrights. And we have a staff of about 100 amazing theater artists who volunteer to help us do that kind of thing throughout the year. We've been doing that, like I said, for 13 years. So Indie Theater Now is sort of a marriage of the reporting and providing context and background and educating and exploring and helping people discover what's great in the theater scene, especially in the indie theater community, and this idea of putting the work out on the internet, the scripts themselves, so that people can read them for themselves. Now, we are not, we are a curated site. Either I personally have seen the work of the playwright or someone already on the site has seen the work. So we're not, it's not an open submission process at this point. We think that's important because we want to make sure that we are able to maintain a level of quality that we understand. We do not give anything away on the site. Well, we give lots of free content away on the site, but we don't give away people's scripts because we think it's really important that the playwright's work be valued. Even if they're a playwright whose work has never been published in a book, if never been on Broadway, never been off Broadway, which is what just about all of our playwrights are. So we charge $1.29 or a little less for subscription plans per play, and playwrights get 30 cents every time that we sell one of their scripts, which admittedly is not a large amount of money, but it's something. And the playwrights, I think, really value the fact that they're getting checks, where before they weren't getting checks. So that's kind of cool. And one of the things that we're really encouraging is trying to build an audience, and this is the big challenge, is to get the word out about Indie Theater Now and get people to understand what it is we're trying to accomplish for these folks who mostly don't have representation of any kind or mostly just starting their careers or even mid-career people who haven't yet hit it, you know. Trying to get the word out so that people that are in positions to help those people with their career find out about their work, discover their work on the site, and we have had some success. We have right now, I think, probably what's arguably our biggest success to date, which is a play called The Curing Room, which we actually published right when we started by a guy named David Ian Lee, who is a local playwright who has since moved to the Midwest because he's getting his MFA. And this is a play that he asked us to publish on the site. We were thrilled to do it. And he got a booking from someone who read it on our site. It's at the Edinburgh Fringe. It looks like it's going to be a hit at the Edinburgh Fringe, and it's booked for a tour in Britain after that. So this guy, who has never made any money as a writer, is making, you know, some money as a writer. And that's beautiful, and he's getting some renown. And we're selling copies of the script to other people as well who are learning about the work. So I'm really excited about the fact that that's happened. And I know that there's two of our playwrights in the room, and I might be more, I just haven't seen you guys. But it's always nice to see them wherever I go. Are there more than two? Three? Are there three? There's three. Sorry.
So both, I'm assuming, and you guys are just dealing in plays or musicals?
Plays and musicals, yeah.
Plays and musicals. And do you represent musicals as well?
I mean, we have musicals. It's hard. Musicals require other kinds of presentation than we're technologically able to do. So we do have some with like links to where you can find the music.
Great. That's a good segue.
Absolutely.
Actually. Yeah.
It's a great segue into newmusictheater.com.
Newmusicaltheater.com.
And so can you guys talk for our audience that may have never been to the site or experienced the site, just what is it? How did it start?
Well, we actually, we started from a different place. Kait and I were specifically just setting out to solve some very specific personal problems we were having, which
professional
was
problems.
Professional problems.
Professional personal problems.
Professional personal problems. Namely, that there were, we had a, it was a lovely problem to have, which was that people wanted to sing our songs, and we wanted to allow them to do so. We had started out, mailing people music and having them mail me $5 in the mail.
And then the internet caught up to
And then the internet got there, and we started using PayPal, and we would have people, and I would email someone, someone would place an order via PayPal on our rudimentary website. There's probably like GeoCities or something, and then someone would, and we would send them the sheet music.
And everything sort of came to a head one Shabbat night when Brian was with his family.
Like Passover, and I was sitting down with my phone just keeps ringing, and I like answer the phone, and someone's like, oh, I can't get the sheet music to such and such.
And they definitely thought they were talking to someone in the Philippines. Or
yeah,
like, you know, they thought they were talking to some customer service person somewhere.
But it's just me.
And it was just Brian.
Me.
And so Brian said, I'm happy to get you your sheet music. I'll do it as soon as we finish dinner. And they said, wait, who am I speaking to?
Like,
and
well, this is like, there's no
Brian,
one else.
It's like, Brian Lowdermilk.
Who else would it
me.
Be?
So that was the moment when Brian came back to the city after his family Shabbat, and he turned to me and he said, we have to find a new solution.
There has to be something else.
We have to do something else. This has to be electronic. So we started looking for platforms to make it electronic and find a way to sort of expedite the process of someone would like to buy our sheet music. We would like to give it to them in a PDF form.
We would like that to be in a protected form.
Yeah, and that was one of the biggest hurdles, was that we decided that we wanted it to be protected in some way. And so
we reached into our pockets, and we, which I can't believe we had the foresight to do, but like we did, and we worked with this lovely web programmer, tech guy named Scott Mevis, and we set about building a platform for our website, and we had very specific things we knew we wanted, such as a robust set of search criteria. We were coming from the place of, let's assume that people knew enough to come here, but not enough to know what to do once they got here. Let's really lead people through and give them... We had the goal of promoting our back catalog in addition to the one or two songs that might have been driving traffic there. So we focused on those search criteria, and we focused on a really simple encryption packet that's just based on, you know, we password protect it with the credit card, and we embed it with the name of the person who purchased it right on the music. Standard stuff, but kind of amazing that we could just do it ourselves. And around that time, we started to be aware of the fact that we were not alone in needing.
And we kept getting questions from other writers who were similarly positioned in their careers, or you know, just a little bit behind us in terms of audience. And they were asking us how to do what we were doing, which at the time was, you know, emailing a PDF to someone, and we didn't have a good solution either. So as we started developing our solution to our own problem, we started looking at other writers who might also want the same problem solved.
Yeah.
And we started with five other writers and teams.
Bench Pasek came on, of the writing team, Pasek and Paul came on board with us at that mm-hmm. point, and his dad's a lawyer, so he helped us do that stuff. And we started with six writers and mm-hmm. rather quickly built up to like 30, and now we're like 50, somewhere around there.
Yeah.
How do you make your decisions as to who's on the site? Is it
that has been a tricky thing to figure out, because we learned all kinds of things in these first couple of years of having this business. Like A, we learned that it was a business, and B,
we had to do accounting,
like just very quickly. I remember like in the first month, like having a conversation with Kurt Deutsch, who runs Shikaboom, and he thought we were adorable, and we're talking about these things. And just like said something to us about, I can't wait for your first accounting quarter. And we're like, what is he even talking about? And then we're like, Kurt, accounting. It wasn't like free to expand it to other writers, and having writers on our site who don't sell content is actually a great cost to the site.
Interesting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It doesn't like effortlessly just like expand. I'm probably saying something that's obvious to lots of people who from the business side.
Business.
We're just like, oh, we'll just have all of the people who write musicals be on this site, and that was tricky.
Which would be great if it was a not-for-profit. But our idea was that because we were coming out of a place where we were saying we as writers want to make money on this. We believe that the site should be something that is a for-profit. It's selling something. It's not just for the. It's for the good of writers, but it's supposed to be for the good of writers. Like it's to sell your work. It's to say I make a living, and we do make a living from our writing.
Yeah.
And so I think that one of the things we've been trying to figure out is we've been trying to sort of find that sweet spot between the commercial side of things and the artistic side of things. And that's true in our writing, and that's true in newmusicaltheater.com, that you're always sort of trying to find that, you're trying to make sure that whatever you're putting on the site is sellable, but at the same time has artistic merit and is, and it's just sort of some sort of weird algorithm of that.
That's kind of an interesting, because I want to talk to you, Sean Patrick, a little bit about the article you wrote today about monetizing content online. Mm-hmm. And so writers that aren't on newmusicaltheater.com or don't have the beta code yet, mm-hmm. or aren't, there are ways to monetize putting your material online and kind of making sure it's protected. Can you talk a little bit to that and kind of what you recommend in terms of, if I was a new writer and had no agent and no idea what to do with my script, what do you recommend?
Yeah, there are a number of ways to do it. As the distribution channels have changed and broadened into a lot of different things, you know, obviously we're not just selling discs via brick and mortar retail. So in the same way that publishing rights have a number of components to them, you have a mechanical royalty component for selling a recording of your work, whether it's a download or a disc. You have a performance through ASCAP or BMI or CSAC. You have a synchronization if it's used in a film, TV, video game, advertising use, that sort of thing. There's all sorts of digital uses which sometimes cross over with those rights. You also have print rights, which for the theater world, there's still quite a lot of value, as they just talked about, in having sheet music. It's the primary way that music is transmitted from one to another, because it's generally involves ultimately a live performance. Mm-hmm. And so the digital sheets business has exploded, especially in the last few years. So I think for somebody who doesn't have representation or doesn't have a relationship with Brian Cater or any of the number of other sites, there are a number of ways to do it. Obviously, you can put it entirely up for free, and some people would advocate that. I think some young, early career writers are so eager to have their work done that they're willing to, oh, it's wonderful that somebody sings my song. The problem is once it's out there, especially once the sheet is out there for free, it's out the door, and it's very difficult to shut the door later. So certainly I think it's okay to give away a little piece of it for free, as I said in the article, so that people know who you are. Because if it's entirely locked behind a paid system and you haven't, literally no one knows who you are, you don't have a presence, you're not known even in the theater world or the music world or what have you, you need to do your own marketing. And so it's helpful to obviously have samples. I think probably the easiest way is to have streaming samples, and if people like it, then they can buy it. You can do I don't advocate for any particular site or program because we're our own publisher as well, but there are a number of avenues you can do to pursue that. There's SoundCloud or which will stream for free. There's Bandcamp, where you can set either a specific price or a pay-what-you-can price. There's TuneCore, which lets you upload things to iTunes and Amazon and Spotify, all these sites. I recently looked and they've got, I think, 80-some stores. Now, some of them aren't a pay-to-listen thing. A lot of them are streaming, which do pay, but in a different way. So, and then there's YouTube, because, the other thing that you didn't mention is that, a lot of the ways that people...
Absolutely.
New to sing your songs at all is the YouTube videos of people singing your song. I mean, you're obviously they're beginning performed all over the place.
No, it's
but that's how they found out about it. They watch the video, they say, I want to sing that song, and they go and buy the sheet music.
And it's frankly the best indicator of whether or not sheet music is going to sell for us or other writers.
Sure.
In our experience.
And right. The main metric we actually use when determining who should be on the site
yeah.
is YouTube views.
Can I ask a sensitive question?
Sure.
So are there...
on the panel, right? They said it's about a personal problem. So.
Yeah.
It's no problem.
And I'm just curious, but I mean, I'm assuming that there are probably some less quality performances of your material
sure.
online.
That's a safe assumption.
I didn't want to use...
I think it's safe to assume there are poor quality performances of any
Everything. Yeah. Let it go.
I think the Great American Songbook has taken some hits
yeah.
as well.
Yeah.
It's rough out there.
Is there value to those performances?
Absolutely.
There's certainly value to the performances. And I think the contrast that I was trying to draw in the article that I wrote, though, was when it's the video that you're choosing to promote of your work. So if you have, obviously, a good quality performance, even if it's a live performance, great. That tends to be, you guys have lucked out on that in a lot of ways, but a lot of people, you know, they think, great, so-and-so singing my song at this cabaret show, I should put the video up. Maybe. I mean,
absolutely.
Often in those cases, you know, you may get someone who's, you know, a prominent performer even to do it, but they may not have had more than an hour's rehearsal, and so no fault of their own, it's not going to be that good. And so the question is that the thing you should choose yourself in how to promote your work? Once the work is out there, there can be any number of covers that are good, bad, and indifferent.
I want to say that Kait and I are very concerned and very, like, We talk a lot about our digital footprint, and we talk a lot about like quality control in our work and in our site's work. Mm-hmm. And there are times when we have a really, really tight gate on it, and like we never release all of the footage from our concerts. Like we curate it, and we really are careful with what we let out there. And then we think there's absolutely a time when you want all hands on deck, and like there are times when we encourage all of our fans, all of our supporters, everybody record a video, like, and but it's not necessarily being released through our channel
mm-hmm.
directly. You know, there's a time to sing Let It Go into your computer screen, but that's not necessarily something
every morning.
But you're not necessarily going to charge to see that performance. You're not necessarily...
Well, and Disney's not going is going to say, please, record it all the times that you want to record
absolutely.
It, but, like, we aren't going to put it on our website.
Yeah.
There's also a difference... not to get into too much of the payment issue, but there is a difference in YouTube, depending on how you monetize it, whether the video is something that you have officially put up in your channel versus some other user-generated content, and whether you opt in to different ad services that will place ads either around or in it, that sort of thing. So, you know, you can still make something off of, you know, someone recording it off their computer screen in their bedroom, but you'll probably make more if it's on your official channel and you've opted into the ad service and all that.
Yeah.
Right. So my question is, as a publisher, a traditional publisher who's dealing with, you know, the older pre-internet model where exposure to a new play was really through kind of you buy the book, you go to drama bookshop, or you get your big Samuel French catalog in the mail, and then you flip through, oh, that sounds good. How are these new models changing relationships with that kind of traditional model? Like, do people need agents anymore? Is this getting more people agents? Are these getting, like, are there thoughts on that, or?
Well, I'll just jump in. I imagine people still need agents. I mean, I'm the person on the panel and maybe one of the few in the room who doesn't make a living as a theater artist, writer, any kind of writer. I mean, we run a nonprofit company to serve the community. So I've never had the problem of trying to get an agent. But my sense from talking to all the people that we deal with is that agents seem to be important to people. I think that, you know, we've always viewed our mission as trying to sort of be the entry point for, you know, and kind of, you know, we always kind of joke, you know, that we haven't invited Tony Kushner to be on Indie Theater Now. If he wants to be on it, he's welcome, but it's kind of, we think he's on his own, you know. I mean, people, you know, we're not looking to service people that have reached a level of stature in their career. We're trying to help people at the beginning. I mean, when you talk about sort of the relationship between digital publishing and sort of traditional print publishing, I mean, we concluded as a as a company who pretty much have stopped being a print publisher as of, I think, the last anthology we published, which was one we did earlier this year, is that it just doesn't make sense from a money standpoint to do print publishing for new work of the kind that we focus on. I'm going to be very clear about that. I'm positive it makes sense to publish the works of Shakespeare. I'm positive that it makes sense to publish the works of Thornton Wilder and many, many other wonderful established playwrights. But I'm also positive that there's no money to be made publishing the works of undiscovered, unrepresented playwrights, which is why we're a nonprofit trying to, you know, use our resources to get those people to a different place in their career. So I feel like I'm sort of rambling, but that is...
No, it's great. I mean, do you have thoughts? Because I know you guys, New Play Exchange has been doing seminars. Can I call them seminars?
Yeah, some of them have been seminar-like.
Yeah, seminar-like.
There are a couple in this very room.
Yeah.
We've been meeting with theater professionals around the country, either in identity groups, so all the world's literary managers and dramaturgs in one room, playwrights in another room, etc., and then lots of mixed groups as well. And we did convene one gathering of agents here in New York, including my own. So I walked down the hall from meeting with her and brought her with me and gathered 30 others in a room and told them all about the New Play Exchange. And we are not putting any agent out of business anytime soon or ever. I think they feel and we agree that our tool is going to be incredibly useful for them. It's a new way for people to find their clients' work, and when they find their clients' work, having found it with a particular mindset that I was looking for exactly this kind of thing, and here it is, and here's my contact information, here's my representative's phone number and email address, so that I can immediately reach out and make a connection. They think it's going to be a tool for that elusive second production for their clients, which is great. And I hope it is. I really do.
Is the goal to have people, do you think agents will one day use this to discover new writers?
It's possible. It really is possible. I mean, we are in such a place now of experimentation and learning and beta testing. And I've built technology now for a couple of decades. So I've acquired a healthy humility about what it is to release a new platform into the wild. The world is going to teach me about what we did. And say, yeah, you know what, look what you did here. You didn't think you were doing this, but you did. And there'll be unintended consequences and things we're going to have to learn from and adapt to. So it may be, I'm 100% certain we're not going to put agents out of business. What might actually happen is agents say, you know what, I find this feature particularly useful in this way you hadn't considered. Can you tweak it this way and that way so I can really use it? And then we'll be like, great, awesome.
Great.
Our intent is to serve the American theater. And so if it's useful for folks, that's what we want to do. We're a nonprofit as well. We're not out to make a buck. We're out to serve.
Do you guys have thoughts on how it's changing relationships?
I don't know if this, I mean, the thing that I feel lately, and Kait, you can totally correct me, is that it's a very strange sensation of having this, like having all of these direct connections with people who want to perform our work. We have like a global network of like, we have people in the Philippines who just like want to sing our songs, and we have actors in the Midwest and lots of students who want to do our work. And we don't really have relationships with people who run those programs, and we don't have relationships with small theaters. And like, we make a living as writers, not like a great living, but like Kait and I are professional writers, and yet like a lot of those normal first routes to like who would be the first line of people you have a business relationship with are not at all who our relationships are with. And there have been some repercussions to that, and it's something that we're now actively trying to figure out how to then have relationships with these, mm-hmm. especially like very small theaters and very small.
Like all your students like us, how do you get to this?
Yeah, like you're not necessarily on the internet.
And that's not connected to your agent exactly, because your agent is connected to the more professional side of your career, and that's sort of, so it's almost, for us it's been a little bit bisected, and I think a lot of the people who are in, at least in musical theater, I don't know as much with plays, I think that because musical theater has a very commercial bent to it, at least a little bit, there's a lot of us who are, the way that we've figured out that we can make our living is to be connecting with people who are buying sheet music from us, and that puts us in a really interesting position over here, and it almost feels completely disconnected from our actual, like, the professional trajectory of the new shows that we're trying to write. The songs are from those new shows.
Yeah.
But
we're theater artists.
Like,
we are, we
it's
swear.
It's a weird thing. It takes a really long time to get a show produced, and so you end up doing this thing on the side over here. And most of our friends, most of the people who are writing, or our contemporaries, are doing the exact same thing.
And just to clarify, because I should have actually clarified this early on, that none of these platforms can bar you from traditional publishing and licensing relationships.
Non-exclusive.
Not at all. None.
Yeah.
It was very important to us as we set it up.
Yeah.
Well, for instance, I have some writer clients who I publish, and we have a deal with newmusicaltheater.com so that they can sell their music via their site as well as all the other places we license their music to.
Great.
I would say that about the agent relationship, there's sort of three primary functions that an agent or a publisher has, or at least a frontline publisher. One is finding the talent, one is promoting the work, and one is making the deal. And I think the value of these sorts of services are helping to find the talent and helping to promote it to some extent. It's not obviously doing the deal. And when you have a situation where you get an actual production opportunity, particularly with a professional theater, it's very important to have somebody to help you make that deal, whether it's an experienced lawyer in the theater world or an agent or someone, so that, as the Dramatists Guild always says, don't sign anything without having somebody smarter than you look at it, or at least smarter than you in a different way. So I think, the music business has obviously used online services to try and find talent as well. A lot of record labels in particular have people who interns who spend a lot of time. I've seen some of these rooms where it's pretty amazing. They have like a dozen people in a room, and they spend all day on YouTube and blogs and other stuff scouting songwriting talent or artist talent, I should say. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. There are a number of people who have huge YouTube or online followings, tens of hundreds of millions of hits on multiple videos. They tend to be performers in their late teens, early 20s, who are mostly singing covers of pop songs. Mm-hmm. And so they have these fan bases. Some of them tour and make a lot of money selling concert tickets. They're not touring arenas, but they're touring, decent venues. There have been not very many situations where that sort of thing has translated into recording income or publishing income. Partly because they're doing covers, but even when they start, some of them start to do their own material, and then there's still a following, but not as much. So I'm not putting it down. I think it's great to be out there, and a lot of the videos are very high quality. I only know a handful who have translated that into the kind of income that would sustain them just from, sort of an online presence kind of thing. I mean, I think the income that you make from selling your songs, whether it's sheet music or videos or what have you, for a theater writer is great. It can be very lucrative, certainly, but of course it's a much better thing to get a production of your work, because royalty wise you're obviously going to make a lot more, and career wise you're going to progress more than that.
That segues. We're having good organic flow. But I also want to bring up, because when I've been to these convenings I talk to a lot of writers and we talk about, should I do this, should I not do this, what does this mean? And I think there still is a vibe or a question in people's mind about the security of these platforms. You guys had mentioned this large fan base, but not necessarily being able to access the theaters. What does that mean in terms of protection of your material, and is that something that the writer has to take on themselves and monitor?
In terms of the sheet music that we sell on the site, you're able to download the sheet music, but as a customer, you're able to download the sheet music But in order to open the file, you have to put your password. You have to put a password in, and the password is your credit card information. So you might share that with your most of them are teenagers. You might share that with your mom, but you're probably not going to share it with anyone else.
It probably was your mom's.
Let's be fair. And then even if you did share that, you could then once you open the file has your name watermarked on the sheet music. So you could totally work around that. There are very analog solutions to working around that.
We won't discuss
that because I don't want to talk about that.
But there are
things that make it very hard to share it, to pirate the music.
You can set up barriers to that. There's very few foolproof kinds of things. And even iTunes and Amazon did away with the DRM on the tracks that they sell a little while ago. You know, there's still fairly heavy DRM on videos.
Can you define DRM?
Digital rights management. So it's the kind of thing that almost everybody doesn't like who isn't in the intellectual property business.
We like it, but...
Yeah. Basically, you're just making it really inconvenient, too.
And other sites have, like, you can print it only once.
Right.
Yeah. Or other sites have it self-destructs in a certain way.
And that's part of it for us, and another part of it is advocacy. And the third part that we also talk about is just making sure that things that people want are available at all, because that's one of the largest drivers of piracy as far as we're concerned. So we think that, like, in general, it's great that, like, we're all just making things available that people should want, or in some cases that we think they should want.
Yeah.
But, like, there's kind of... we sit on a piracy committee here at the Dramatists Guild with Sean and with some other writers that's led by Craig Carnelia. And did a piracy, what was it called?
Blast.
Like a Ships Ahoy. A blast. We did a pirate blast here in this very room a couple months ago. And it's been wonderful. We spend a lot of time sitting around and talking about both the DRM side of it, but mostly about the advocacy side.
And really talking about, the fact that if we have the expectation, and we're not even teenagers, that if I look on the internet, I should
basically
be able to find
teenagers,
something.
We're basically teenagers.
But if I look around the internet for something, I expect to be able to find it. And if I can't, I get frustrated very quickly. And so if you can't buy something and you want to be able to access it, even I teach a libretto writing course, and like there's nothing that's harder to find anywhere than librettos. And so I end up emailing writers and asking to borrow their libretto and telling them that I'm going to make a couple photocopies for my students to look at hard copies of. But like, they're saying it's okay, but I really wish that wasn't the way that I had to do it. Like, I should just tell my students to buy this libretto, which I would totally do, but I can't because it's not available on the internet for the most part. So that's, it's hard. It's confusing.
Do you feel like, I know you probably addressed the security question in your...
Yeah, you know,
seminars.
The writer in my seminars.
I don't know what to call those.
The writers we've been meeting with around the country, and I've probably met, feels like 1,000 now at this point. They're mostly playwrights rather than musical theater writers. I talk a lot about people my age and above are really concerned about privacy, and they don't want their script available. And we've set up the new play exchange so that you can create an entry for your play and not add the script. You can add a little sample, you can add a synopsis, you can add the information about the script, and then require someone to contact you if they want to read it. And people younger than me are like, put the script up there. And these are represented people and unrepresented people. These are, they information wants to be free. If there's an unlicensed production of their work in Zaire, great, they don't care, in the age of the Google alert about your work, when you can have that, set that up, you're always going to find out about anything, just be savvy and be smart. And so I can see both perspectives, and I live right in that vague center. I tend to side with the younger folk, but I totally see the other perspective. And if you look at my profile in New Play Exchange, you'll see There's about half and half of my work. The published work is not there because I would not do a disservice to my publisher by putting a free-ish accessible copy of it up there. The unpublished work, some of it is up there and some of it isn't. And it's really about what I'm feeling like. It's not logic.
Is there some concern about what you put online being the finished edition? I know we wrestle with that question at French because, you know, a lot of playwrights these days and historically go back and kind of change the work as they see new productions or... Mm-hmm. You know, we have plays that mention MySpace.
We have a rule always that playwrights can revise the work. I mean, not every week, but you know, certainly we're happy to put up new versions as the plays develop. And I've actually been, you know, I think maybe not too high pressure, but trying to encourage people to put work up, even, you know, as it's just being performed for the first time, so that it gets the exposure. I mean, one of the things I didn't talk about this before, but it's called Indie Theater Now for a very specific reason, and that is that we're publishing plays as they're being presented for the first time. So, like, there is a play that opens, I guess, tonight at the Midtown International Theater Festival, not a famous venue, but a real one, and that play is published on Indie Theater Now. It's a world premiere of the play. And I know he wants to revise it after he sees the first run, and he will, and that's great, but at least the work is available for people to see, and in fact, this guy already got a production in Britain from the work that's on our site, so the idea works. I wanted to also just talk about what Woody was just talking about, too, because it's really important to me, and that's this idea of... making sure that the work is secure and is safe. And I mean, I'm very much a fervent believer in the rights of any creator to be able to profit from their work. I get mad at the New York Times that it wants to charge me to read their articles, but they're right. I mean, what they did wrong was give them away for free for a really long time, so that I'm mad now. If they'd always charge me, I wouldn't, because they used to charge me, used to pay for this paper. So, Indie Theater Now is set up right from the start to be protective in its own way of the rights of these playwrights. We have a proprietary reader that we developed that is meant to be a reader of the plays. It is not an acting copy by any means of the play. You could sit and print screens and cobble together an acting copy of the thing, but that would be really a lot of work. I mean, you could do it, but it would be a lot of work. I would be smarter to contact the playwright and try to work something out with the playwright, and we provide all that contact information on the site. We chose the iTunes pricing model, and that's why the play is called $1.29. It was not a guess, it was the iTunes price, because our thought was that our main market is probably younger people, and especially kids in schools, because that's really our main market, or people who are reading these plays in colleges, and they think nothing of spending $1.29 for assigned work or for work they're going to use for their own purposes. And we've got, you know, one of our absolute best-selling play is a play by a guy who teaches in this area, and he teaches a course in theater at a number of schools in the New York City area, and he always used to give his play away and now he gets 30 cents every time one of the students buy it, and they all will buy it because it's only $1.29. And we can always tell when he's teaching it because they'll be damn, he's like 17 copies of the play, because the kids don't buy it in advance, that's for sure. So, but I think it's really important to protect. We've met with a number of groups of playwrights. I'm sorry if I'm going on too long, but we've met with a number of groups of playwrights, and what I hear from the folks we talk to is, and it's not really so much age-related, it's just what we give them. It's everybody that we work with, obviously, is happy to let people have a reading copy of the play for the $1.29, but almost no one that we work with wants a PDF out there. They don't want a printable, usable, actable copy. They want that to be theirs to control. And as we don't do licensing, and we're not interested in getting into that business, you know, that is great with us. But, you know, it does limit, in a way, some of the usability of what we're doing on the site. But again, our purpose is to introduce the work to anybody who wants to get introduced to it.
Can I ask a question? Can you read it on a tablet?
You can read it on anything that can connect to the internet.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's not that you have to sit and read it on the screen of your laptop.
No. You can read it on your phone. Right. I mean, I wouldn't, but you can. But you, but what you have to be is connected, because you cannot download it.
Yeah, and you can.
Yeah, so you can't read it on the subway.
I see.
Gotcha. Unless you're really lucky.
They live in D.C., where we have
the
stuff.
Yeah.
I have one more question, and I want to turn it over to everyone for larger questions. But for those of you that are artists as well as kind of digital innovators, how does this work with an author's own website? I'm assuming that you have your own websites, and then you're also using these other platforms. I mean, does that become cumbersome? Do you find that you get more traffic to your website from other platforms? Do you recommend that playwrights have multiple accounts with various, as many accounts as possible, or is it about...
I don't know. I mean, we have newmusicaltheater.com, which brings in very different people, and different people might find our work because of that, because they're looking for another artist's work, and so that's great. And being on YouTube, and our YouTube account is one of our biggest ways that people find us, and that happens probably through Google sometimes, and then sometimes it's just through YouTube, and then it's people who are subscribers of our page. And then we have a website, which there are moments where I wonder whether or not that's actually worthwhile, given all of the different platforms that people now use. But we made our website something that is sort of its own beast and has its own identity. We keep all of our lyrics for all of our songs on our website, and we house them there. And so that's something that we know that people are looking for, and so we know that people will go to our website for certain things, and so it seems useful, but
we can't help it. We have a front row seat from our perch at New Musical Theater, and so we can't help but like translate the best practices we figure out over there to our own work. And so like when we went about like finally like fixing our website last year, it was, if you searched for us, it came up as like Kentucky off-track betting, because like something happened and we couldn't fix it, but we finally did, and it was really interesting. We like looked at our Google Analytics, which I recommend everybody install because it's free and simple, and we were like, oh wow, everyone just wants the lyrics to our songs. Like, this is the way they're finding us.
And you're giving those away.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so we just, like, put all our lyrics up on our site, but at least they're not somebody else who's getting the traffic. Right. And so we put it up on us, and they're accurate.
Yeah.
And when they change, we update them. And I did want the chance to respond to your last question, which is that, like, no, just to say that I've gotten so accustomed to changing my work at will. And, like, we have three different versions of some of our songs online because... You know, like, it's really hard. People don't want you to take away their old one. And
they
like,
really liked that key change.
They really liked the old one that you didn't like very much that had the really bad lyrics. Like, what are you going to do? And so, like, we leave that up there, but we actually even call it, like, preferred version
and,
or
like,
something.
Retired version.
We call it, like, don't sing this song, but here, fine, because you...
Stop emailing me.
It's a weird thing to think about, like, the first time we're in, like, physical print. Like, we talk about... That's a weird thing. Like, we just can't just change it when we want to.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. Do you have writers who, like, we're gonna be awful to deal with when we have a print, if we have a print deal, if books aren't just all gone, because I want to be able to change it.
Well, some of the print publishers, Alfred and Hal Leonard, now have digital print services, where it's more than print on demand, but they can do very small quantities of a very nice looking book. It's almost indistinguishable from what you would buy if they made 10,000 of them.
Mm-hmm.
But for, even though sheet music is very popular for theater still, physical sheet music, it's not as big a business as it used to be. And so the marketability of, let's say, a vocal selections folio of an off-Broadway show that's closed is limited. And so, you know, but that's not to say we shouldn't have it there. So we always put the songs up digitally for individual sale, where there's a number of different sites. And we also try and, you know, make it so that it's available. So if there is a marked demand for it, then they can make 100 of them and sell those. And they don't need to have the same print run press point because, as I think Mark was saying, you know, in the print, in the cost of paper and binding and all of that is just prohibitive. In many cases. I wanted to, the other question you were asking
about websites.
So I always encourage the writers I represent, particularly the younger ones, to have a website, to have it look at least basic and decent, and to have a consistent name for the domain name and their Twitter handle and their YouTube channel and their Facebook, if they have a professional, you know, fan page or whatever, so that people always know, even if they're not, no matter how they're going at it, they're always finding that person. You know, and then of course there are links on there to purchase their music in many different ways from many different sites. I have an example. Well, it's interesting though, because what you were saying about the website, I think different people have different things. Like, I represent Lin-Manuel Miranda, who has a huge social media following, mainly because he's very active on it. He's on there many times a day. And so he did this 15-minute musical for Ira Glass on This American Life a few weeks ago. And it was performed live at BAM, and they did a video, and they sold the video on the This American Life website. Ira Glass and Lynn emailed me and said, we're gonna go into the studio. The day after they shot the thing, or maybe a couple days later, they went into a studio and recorded the cast album EP of five tracks of this 15-minute show. The video is great. I would encourage everyone to buy the video. The album is also great. The audio quality on the album is better than it is in the video because they had time in the studio to do it. But we were able to, we published his songs. He wanted to self-release the audio. It was too short a timetable to get a label involved in that sense because it was 3 days. Mm-hmm. But we got it up on iTunes in 3 days and Amazon. So, and it debuted at number 10 on the cast albums chart because because he tweeted it and he has 50 some thousand Twitter followers, and that's where they found it. They didn't follow it by going to his website.
I mean, I consult for arts organizations and artists about digital communication strategy. And I think at this point we're living in a world where having a competent website is tantamount to what having a competent CV was about a decade or a generation ago. You kind of have to.
Yeah.
And it's really not that hard. It requires maybe a mental leap to decide that you can do it. But you can do it. You can do it for $100 and a lost weekend, right?
You have to drink while you're doing it?
You do. Yeah, really.
Don't drink after you're done.
Or you can hire somebody fancy to do it for you, but it's just, you know, do it yourself. Having said that, I think it's important to not get overwhelmed. And so I tell the artists that I work with, to pick a channel and go deep rather than try and do 9 channels shallowly, or pick 3 channels and go deep. My channel, as many of you know, is Twitter, and I spend a lot of time there, and I've got a following there, and it's worked for me. And I also have a rather robust website that, because I can't not. And I also play around with every new platform that comes out because I have to know them. But I can't devote my life to that. I really have to make it work, and that's important too.
So I'm gonna turn it over to the audience, which we're about a half an hour. So let's start. You raised your hand first. The gentleman in the white hat.
Okay. Firstly, I want to say that I appreciate and I value what you guys are doing. The world is going in technology direction, and that's important. A lot of people want to be sites that don't read the terms and conditions, rules, regulations, but there's usually a clause that they're granting the site perpetual rights. And if it's not there, it should be there. Because someone could come around later on and sue you, they didn't take your work down, you've had it on your site. My question is, what repercussions does that have for the person who's posting their work on your site?
So this is a question about perpetual rights, and what repercussions do we have for people posting your work?
I mean, basically, the way we do it is that the playwright has the right to take the work down anytime they want after it's been up for 6 months. We ask them to give it 6 months because there's a certain amount of investment that we've made in more time and resources. But after 6 months, playwrights can take the piece down for any reason, no questions asked. The only condition is that anybody who's purchased one of their digital plays for $1.29 gets to keep the play forever. But other than that, the play's gone. So it's a pretty fair arrangement.
We don't ask for perpetual rights at all. Mm-hmm. The artist can take it down 6 seconds after they put it up.
What if they don't? And it's your great-great-grandson.
What are you asking?
What if a future generation finds your grandfather's work on your site? What protection do you have? Like I said, there is value to that clause.
Well, we're not making any money off of it. So, there's not, we don't need protection.
Yeah, we have an agreement. We have signed agreements not digital, but like actual real signed agreements with every single playwright. So if the grandson, I guess, asks us a question, we can show them the agreement.
But that, is that something for writers to be mindful of, I guess, as they explore these new platforms?
Well, the terms of the, you know, in our case, the writers that we represent, they have an agreement with Warner Chappell, or as you would with any other publisher. And that has either a certain term. It can be 3 years, it can be life of copyright, in a number of things. And then wherever that work appears is a license between the publisher and that site. So that license can be usually for a fixed amount of time. If a writer, in most of our agreements, I shouldn't say all because I don't know for sure, but if I know in a lot of them that I deal with, if a writer doesn't want their work on a site, we usually have the right to pull it off. If for whatever reason, sometimes they want to revise it, sometimes they want to, who knows? You know, some people don't want their work on certain sites because they don't like the deal terms, they don't like the site itself, who knows? But usually, I mean, I don't think I'm not sure websites are going to be around in their current form in 20 years, much less 100.
The question is because sites like Wattpad, Writer's Cafe, they have that clause.
So they have the perpetual right to keep
yes.
it up?
Wow.
I wouldn't load my work there at all.
No. Well, and I think that's also because, I mean, Martin, you've been a major advocate, but for the rest of us, like, we're also writers, and like, so of course, from the very outset, that was a non-starter. Like, there just had to be something in it. Like, that was the, like, New Musical Theater is a for-profit company that's mostly trying to make a living or a supplemental living for a lot of its writers, and yours is a nonprofit. But like, regardless, there's a writer-friendly thing that's happening underneath it, and there's something about it that like that's paramount, is the right to take that work down and to be in control of it.
I'm sorry, but a related thing that I've been hearing from various playwrights that I find very concerning is people saying that they're online publishers are requiring an exclusive arrangement. Mm. And if I were a playwright, I would not let anyone in the world have an exclusive rights
to my online.
That was our, that's like the birthright I pass on to my, like that's.
That.
Yeah, but that was exactly, I mean, because we were writers, when we were creating the agreement for this company and other writers that we were also signing, so that there was that sense that it had to be something that is non-exclusive. That was... Right.
Not to sound like a paid program for the Dramatists Guild, but writers who are unrepresented or don't have a publisher to go back to and talk about these issues, I mean, if any of you do have agents, publishers, you know, ask them before you post on a website, definitely will help you out, but you do not, I mean, the Dramatists Guild is also a wonderful resource, and join them and run it by them. Say, hey, I found this, I was just looking over terms and conditions. What does this mean? Should I post? And I think that, you know, they're a wonderful resource to kind of walk you through that.
And sometimes we get questions if a writer will find a new site that pops up and says, you know, asks us, is it okay if we put this there? And sometimes we already have an agreement with that site, so then we contact the site and say, please put this person's stuff up. So it's
great. You had a question, too, in the front row.
Yes, I had a question regarding, you know, an interface that could be built. And this is just a question to see how viable or what other people have utilized this. An interface that when the person goes to download the PDF, whether it be sheet music, whether it be play, I'm not necessarily talking about recorded music in this instance, but a pop-up that basically, you know, you agree by downloading this that the terms are X, like for example, you will not sell this, or you will not, you know, that this is for purchase of an individual copy. Is that something that would apply?
We have that built into the terms and conditions for anyone who signs into the new play exchange.
Right, okay. So, I mean, in a way, when you were talking about the idea of the watermark and when you're getting around it, I mean, if someone signed the terms and conditions thing, it doesn't inhibit them from sending a PDF to China.
But it does make it something that they shouldn't have done.
Right,
and we've told them as many times as we could.
Yes. Okay,
Let's make it illegal.
And even if we don't tell them that they can't do it, yes, it is illegal.
It's what we do.
The laws of the country make it illegal, not us.
Okay, so I just, I mean, in terms of all the platforms that we're talking about, that's something that's consistent to all of them. So any kind of a platform like that, that's...
Yep, still, it's always illegal.
Like, I mean, people just, like, make photocopies of plays all the time.
That's illegal, too.
Historically, that was the equivalent, I think, is the photocopy method. Do we have a Twitter?
Yeah, we have a lot of questions on Twitter.
I think I'm having a
Hi, Twitter! No worries.
The
internet has so many questions. So I have a couple here. Maybe I can throw out two of them. The first one is, let me see here. Do any of the panelists up here plan to push into licensing?
No.
I don't know. What's licensing? Get? Like,
you're talking about grant rights licensing. Licensing the whole works.
Yeah. I don't know.
It's a complicated other thing.
It's complicated. It seems like, I mean, certainly for the major licensing houses, it's shifting, it's changing, it's becoming digital. Like, how much, like, we sell 90% of our scores. Like, you can buy, like, almost the entire score. There's not much left. It's just, like, some underscoring. And then a PDF of the script, which I guess they could get over on the other table. So, like, so it really becomes what
we're... That doesn't give them the right, though.
No, it doesn't. No, of course. But I'm saying that barrier to entry in that world is not so far away. And so then it becomes all about the relationship between the licensor and the theaters, and there's and for great licensors, there's a history, and certainly it's something that, you know, Sam French does, which is to, like, really curate those relationships. There's something that is more than just the sheer act of passing on materials. But it's a weird thing, and it's now something that I imagine for. Amy is sitting up here and can probably speak to it, but that's something that I imagine is shifting and becoming, and that relationship between theaters and licensing houses is also probably becoming a digital one.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think, you know, Samuel French has seen some major innovations of how we handle music materials at our theaters. You know, I think it's not that I want to become a panelist, but, you know, we also entered into e-plays, and a lot of that was, and I can say as also a literary manager, as well as a French employee, the days of those scripts on desk, and you're eating your lunch and softly crying on the scripts, you know, it just became about my back, actually. I just wanted to carry digital scripts. And so, you know, we're kind of answering these demands as we...
Now you cry on your iPad.
I cry into my iPad. No.
Warner Chappell doesn't license... We license grand rights for usually pre-existing songs that are not theater songs. So, for instance, we did American Idiot because we represent Green Day. That's right, and we have songs in Rock of Ages and Lady Day and a number of other things like that. In the UK and Europe, we do have a stock and amateur grand rights licensing for some musicals. But generally, we work in partnership with Semi French and MTI and the other licensing houses to handle grand rights.
Courtney, did you have another song?
Yeah, I have one more. Danica Kelly was asking, are there any downfalls to publishing on an online platform instead of in print? So it has been a lot of, online is awesome. So now the question is, what would be the downfalls of online and not print?
Yeah, are there any pitfalls in your own personal experiences and your histories with these that you didn't anticipate, I guess?
Well, I mean, this is the worst thing for me to say, but I hate to read plays online. I'd much rather read a book. But I'm 53 years old, and I'm used to reading plays and books. I mean, and so it doesn't really matter what I think, because kids that aren't used to reading books, that's who we're really building this for. I think that's a downfall, though. I think that the feel of books is something that a lot of people miss. I mean, there are certainly people that we have not been able to sell plays to because they can't read it as a book. And I remember an email we got, somebody said, you're probably really nice people, and this play is really good, and I won't buy it because I can't read it in my computer. I don't know that there's another downfall. I mean, I think that it would be crazy for us to put our heads in the sand and say that digital presentation of work is like not the trend. Like, I mean, it's not even just the trend, it's like it is. So it's the way that people are going to be receiving work. And I think the important thing is to make sure that the same respect and care and love that was that creating a book made you do because it was hard. It's really easy to publish stuff online. I can publish a blog post in like 3 minutes. And I don't, you know, if you don't, you don't feel like you have to proof it so much, you don't think the words make so much, and you should. These things, these plays are beautiful works of art, and they must all be, we must guard against thinking that this is some kind of factory that we, oh, I can publish 20 billion of these in a week. No, we can't. We have to take our time with them, and we have to treat them with love. And as long as we do that, then the digital platform is only a great thing because it's putting the work out. Like I said, we were able to publish almost 1,000 plays in the time it would have taken us to publish about 20, and really for way less actual cash out the door. I mean, so isn't that great? Isn't it great that we're able to get this work in front of people who wouldn't have ever had an opportunity to see it? Again, as long, and you know, and I take great pride in what we do. We do everything by hand as much as we can in this digital world, and I personally edit every script. And, you know, that's, I don't see a downside besides that.
You look like
The New Play Exchange is not a publisher, so this is my answer as an author. I'm wary of books. I don't trust books, right? Books are fixed and done and unchanging. But a digital book can change and can grow and can morph. I love the idea that a book could be published and then a new edition could come out in a week when I find a typo or when I decide a new reference is better. I love that you can put out new versions of your songs whenever you feel like it. I love that your art is a living thing. I think that is the future. You know, it doesn't mean that I didn't put thousands of hours into writing that first draft and plenty of care and love into it, but this artificial stopping point for a piece of art that's meant to live in a room with other people there, called publishing, and that artificial stopping point, I just don't trust. It creates a kind of fake snapshot of the work, and I'm saying this as someone who's been published and has work in print, and you know, I just am always really like I sidle up to it carefully because I don't think we should stop.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I would say that the negative is that, because I think there are there's a plethora of positives, but the negative is that there is a gap in accessibility that exists, especially right now, and certainly we end up in situations where we're dealing with customer service where someone who's the head of a theater program in the Midwest and wants to put the new musical theater songbook in their library, and we don't really have a good way to help them do that, and that's really frustrating for them, and it's really frustrating for us because we want nothing more than to be a part of that canon and to be a part of what is considered to be theater right now, like theater now, and the things that people are giving to their students to sing. And so it ends up being I think that access, the more platforms you can have your work on, the more access people can have to your work. And so I think that for me, as someone who also loves to read things in my hands, I find that when there's the possibility of having multiple platforms, when there's the possibility of having something physical and having something that's digital, I don't think they cancel each other out. And right now, especially when we are in an enormous transition and we don't know exactly where we're going to land, I think that's really important.
I want to say the thing that for me is both like an enormous positive and also the thing I'm most scared of in the publishing world in general, which is that the year that we founded New Musical Theater was that first year that Amazon was getting in a price war with ebook publishers back in like 2009. And like to now be sitting at here when they're in the war with Hachette. The thing that was absolutely terrifying to me in the background of all the really logical reasons that we started New Musical Theater was this intense fear that if we didn't do something, Kait and I, to like specifically create a method to sell our work ourselves and to protect 100% of our rights, someone was going to come in very quickly and like destroy the world and collapse everything and do what happened in the record industry 15 years ago. And that, like, it was just going to be smoke and ash everywhere. It really, I was terrified in 2009 and so we, in 2008, so we just acted really quickly and in our self-interest. And I have been really happy to see that our industry moves at a glacial rate in regards to technology. It's been like a really lovely thing to just watch as, like, as there is smoke and ash everywhere in industries like ours, but it's like we're so small, shh, internet, leave us alone. Like, it's like we've been small enough so as to, like, stay under the radar and keep a lot of our revenue streams intact. And I just, like, I'm so terrified. Still, there's still part of me that is a bit of a technophobe that, like, that deals with all of this and, like, works on all of it in the hope that, like, no one's gonna burn the place to the ground. So I just, like, hope that people who love theater will continue to, like, be at the helm of for-profits and non-profits and all kinds of new emerging companies that are built with, you know, writers and writers' rights in mind, because the alternative is freaking horrifying.
Yeah, I more because people ask us when we started and ask us still now, why can't you put your plays on Kindle? And wouldn't they sell really well if you put on Kindle? Wouldn't that be a great thing? And I guess it might be a great thing, but the problem is as soon as I put you on Kindle, then your
smoke
play is... Well, not just that. It's not even just Amazon's fault. I mean, it's that your play, which right now is one of 955 plays, and that's all they are, is plays. Your play on Kindle is now one of, you know, 22 billion things that Amazon sells, and as soon as I look at your play,
yeah, or a garden
say,
hose.
Oh, look, Joy of Cooking. Oh, look, Playboy. Oh, look, this. Oh, look, a video. Oh, look, Amazon Prime. And I don't want my audience to go away. I want my audience to stay right here. So, I mean, I think we have the same kind of very proprietary, and that's people that make theater tend to be very independent souls. Thank God.
Thank God.
I want to wrap this up because I know, I think Brian and Kait do need to be out the door, but I think a great question to kind of end this wonderful panel, and I thank you guys all so much because I think this has been informative and there's lots of great quotes and talking points. Where do you hope your platforms go in the future? What is the vision? Like 10 years down the road, what is New England? And this is a huge question to end on, so I hate to, but where do you see digital publishing in 10 years?
I would very much like for the New Play Exchange to become two things in 10 years. One is the digital infrastructure that supports the backbone of the new play sector of the American theater, and also an archive of the previous 10 years of work that's been done in the American theater.
I think most practically, I would love to see us sooner than 10 years be self-sustaining so that we don't have to keep begging donors for money to keep us alive. And I think that's a very possible thing to do. And I would love us to, I mean, actually, what Gwydion just said sounds good to me, too. I think that, you know, I don't know if we'd be the backbone, but I think that we could be a really important contributor to keeping, providing discovery of new work, and mainly conversation about new work. I mean, discovery and conversation and exploration are really the key goals, so that people can not just find new plays for school, for production, for pleasure, but also, hopefully, you know, almost be kind of a Facebook-y kind of community where it's really discussed in an intelligent and supportive and generous way.
That's what I think of Facebook when I think of Facebook, yeah. And supportive and generous.
Yes,
and
exactly. That's the difference.
Intelligent.
Yes.
Yeah. For New Musical Theater, I think we're... Our goal has from the beginning been to have a platform for writers to make a living, and we're constantly looking for ways to help the writers do that better and to create a situation where the site is helping the writers do that better, not just through advice, but how the actual site works, so that there's more people coming to the site, that we're using the site in a way that that people can find things and that people are finding new writing and that they're looking for new writing is something that's really important to us. And not necessarily the easiest thing to get people who even love new writing to do because they like what they know. So I think that's a big part of it for me. I don't know if you have anything to add.
That's a good answer. I hope that there are lots of things about the site that, like, 10 years from now, like I wouldn't even recognize. Yeah. You know, like I hope it's all kinds of things that I can't even imagine.
But also no smoke.
Yeah, no smoke, no fire.
Dragons.
Yeah.
The future. are people just going to be using their iPads and no paper plane?
No, I think there's always going to be some market for some form of high-end audio and maybe some form of vinyl or nostalgic media. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you know, digital downloads have now surpassed physical sales, permanent digital downloads, and streaming services are on the rise. We're very, you know, much more, the entire music industry is much more nimble than it was, you know, 12 years ago, 15 years ago, certainly. Making deals with, licensing deals with all sorts of companies. You know, I think the hope is that the streaming service, people will actually pay the subscription fees for the streaming services, because the monetization to the songwriters and the recording artists is much greater if the song is streamed by a subscriber than it is for a free customer when it's just an ad-supported model, and that's true of almost all of the services. And, you know, I think history has borne out that people are willing to pay for access if they have a system that they like that's easy to use and has a wide variety of things to choose from. So there are any number of competing services now. I don't know, you know, I'm not going to try and predict which will be most successful, but my guess is that it's still going to be some combination of old media downloads and streaming.
Great. Thank you so much. I know you guys have to jump, but can I? Yeah.
This was fantastic. Thank you as you're running out. Y'all were awesome. But yeah, feel free to stick around for a few more questions. And just a reminder that tomorrow is our final panel at Samuel French, and we have a fun little thing after. So please come, 6:30. And it's a catch-all, piracy in the digital age. Who knows what will be discussed? So please join us. Thank you so much for moderating today.
Myrne, thank you.